Hi everyone. So now let's talk about the hormones of labor. Hormones are like little messengers inside your body. And there are six major hormones that we're going to talk about related to birth. And for some of these hormones, I'm going to be using Play-Doh to kind of mimic the fact that they are little molecules floating through your body. So the first one we're going to talk about are prostaglandins. Prostaglandins cause a lot of different effects in your body, but in late pregnancy, it helps prepare your body for labor by ripening your cervix, meaning it helps get your cervix softer, thinner, starts effacing more. Prostaglandins are also present in semen, which is why sometimes you hear people talking about having sex to hopefully naturally move that process along. Oxytocin is another really important hormone. It's often called the love hormone, and this hormone promotes attachment and bonding. It can make you feel really calm. It also can induce contractions and enhance the parent-baby bond, as well as the bond between two partners. Beta-endorphins are pain-relieving hormones that are the body's natural way of relieving pain. They activate the reward center in your brain. Beta endorphins make you feel really good. Sometimes you may hear people talking about getting a runner's high when they run. That's because these beta endorphins are released with exercise. Beta endorphins peak at the time of birth, and they decline over the next 30 to 60 minutes. Epinephrine and norepinephrine are what we call catecholamines. These are hormones that are sometimes referred to as the fight or flight hormones. If you ever hear a loud noise or you see something flying towards you really quickly, you might feel this rush or surge of fear going through your body. That's from catecholamines. And so those can be present with higher levels of stress or when you have a sense of danger. Prolactin is the hormone of breastfeeding and attachment. And so that's what's responsible for helping you breastfeed or chest feed your baby. And then finally, cortisol is a stress hormone that helps the baby's lungs mature before they're born. So in late pregnancy and early labor, there is an increase in levels of many of these hormones. And not only these hormones, but their receptors, which I'll talk about in a minute, especially for oxytocin towards the end of pregnancy and in labor. Progesterone goes up, which is another hormone that we haven't talked about, and endorphins and prolactin, they're all preparing you for the moment of birth. Let's imagine that there's a baby inside here. It's the end of pregnancy, and there's these little receptors all over the uterus, but they're hidden for most of pregnancy, and it's not till you get close to the start of labor that these receptors start to pop up all over the uterus, and these are mostly going to be receptors for oxytocin, which I'm going to demonstrate in just a second if I can hold these straws in place. So as you get close to the start of labor, these receptors are popping up and oxytocin can float around and bond or attach to these receptors. And that can eventually start labor. So this is why if you induce someone with oxytocin through an IV, so you can give artificial oxytocin through a vein, sometimes if you can do that too early before the body is ready, these receptors are hidden. And so you can be trying to, you know, give oxytocin through the vein, but there's nothing for them to latch onto. So that's why sometimes you can have an induction that doesn't go anywhere. Sometimes they call it a failed induction, or they say my contractions never really picked up with the induction. That's because you have to have these receptors popping up in order for the oxytocin to have something to latch onto. And sometimes people go in to have oxytocin started, but they can't get the induction started, and that's because those receptors were not ready yet. It's also kind of cool that in the baby inside their body, they have receptors that are starting to pop up at the time of birth or close to the time of birth as well. And particularly for babies, their receptors for the catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine, are popping up. And that is to prepare them for the birth of the baby. They're going to have a surge of catecholamines in their own body right at the time of birth that helps them with that transition outside the womb and with the beginning of breathing. So if someone's going through labor, through the process, the hormone of oxytocin in particular is going to keep rising and rising and rising until you have higher levels of oxytocin running through the bloodstream. This oxytocin is going to peak at the pushing phase to help your body expel the baby from the uterus and promote the actual birth of the baby. And then again, after the birth, the oxytocin is going to peak as well to help promote the uterus to contract, and I'll explain why. So after the baby is born, we already talked about how stage three is when the placenta is born. So after when the placenta is being born, it literally has to peel away from the inside of the uterus. And then the uterus has to clamp down or contract down because there's a placenta-shaped wound on the uterus. So the uterus is going to clamp down or contract to prevent that wound from bleeding. And so you need that oxytocin to help that uterus contract again after the birth. This will help prevent what we call postpartum hemorrhage, which is excessive bleeding after the birth. Prolactin is also starting to peak in the last hour of labor or so to help promote breastfeeding or chest feeding for when the baby is born. And then also beta-endorphins, those natural pain-relieving hormones, are also going up with the strength of contractions, which helps provide some pain relief. Now, if there are good or normal levels of stress in the birthing room, catecholamines, those fight or flight or stress hormones, can actually be a little bit helpful because at the very end of your labor, when you're pushing, they help you become naturally more alert, more awake, and ready to get a surge of energy to push your baby out. Now, earlier in labor and in active labor, people tend to be more focused, more inwardly focused. They're kind of in a zone. You'll see it when you see it, just somebody's very inwardly focused. And that has to do with the type of hormones that are flooding their body at that time. But when you get to the pushing phase, you're going to experience that surge of the catecholamines that will naturally make you feel really excited and ready to push effectively. However, if these catecholamines are activated earlier in labor, this can be harmful. So say the birthing person is frightened or not coping well, or they're exposed to a lot of bright lights or needles or things that increase their level of fear. This can slow down labor because you'll have too many catecholamines, too many fight or flight hormones in that early labor. And your body naturally doesn't want to give birth if you're in fight or flight mode. It'd be like asking a deer to give birth to a fawn while a wolf is chasing it. I already mentioned earlier that at the end of labor, there's also a surge of catecholamines in the baby that help prepare the baby to take their first breath. Unfortunately, you don't get that surge of catecholamines with a C-section or cesarean, which is why researchers think that when babies are born vaginally, that they tend to do better with their breathing and they have fewer admissions to the intensive care unit. Because babies that are born vaginally get that surge of hormones right before they were born vaginally, and that doesn't happen with a cesarean. There are many things that can interrupt this complex dance of hormones, and unfortunately, one of those things that can interrupt the dance is medications. So if you're giving someone medications through an epidural that interrupts the body's natural production of oxytocin, prolactin, beta-endorphins, and catecholamines, and it prevents all of these hormones from peaking as high at the end of labor. So the hormones will go up a little bit, but not as high as if you weren't giving these medications. An epidural in particular leads to a decrease in the maternal oxytocin. And because of that, oftentimes after you receive an epidural, you will see your contractions start to slow down or get weaker. And that's because that there was an interruption in the birthing person's own natural production of oxytocin. And then that often leads to needing to give oxytocin through the vein intravenously. However, one problem with giving IV oxytocin is if you receive prolonged IV oxytocin, say for example you're having a long induction of labor and they've been giving you oxytocin through your IV for many hours, or you're being given oxytocin for many hours because you had an epidural, which slowed down labor, having oxytocin, too much oxytocin, can desensitize these receptors. So these receptors get flooded with so much oxytocin from the IV that the receptors start to reject the oxytocin. They start to say, like, I don't like oxytocin. There's too much oxytocin. There's too much oxytocin floating around. And unfortunately, if these receptors get desensitized, that can increase the risk of bleeding or postpartum hemorrhage after the birth. Because after the birth, the uterus is not able to clamp down on that wound from the placenta as much because the receptors have been desensitized to the high levels of oxytocin that were given IV. One more really interesting thing about hormones is at the end of labor, immediately after the baby is born, the birthing person, if they did not have medications given to them, are flooded with endorphins, which many people describe feeling the biggest high or surge of their life. And that emotional high or that reward can stick with people for the rest of their life, and they always remember what that emotion felt like. Not everybody feels that rush with the endorphins, but that rush is related to the surge of endorphins right after the baby is born. And this is Maria, my little birthing doll. I haven't shown her to you yet, but I wanted to use her to demonstrate that putting the naked baby on the mother's bare chest after birth promotes levels of oxytocin and prolactin. And the oxytocin goes up in the baby and the birthing person. And we think that this surge in oxytocin with the baby doing skin to skin with the parent decreases the risk of postpartum hemorrhage. It supports breastfeeding and bonding, and it helps babies regulate their temperature and their blood sugar. Another interesting thing they've found is that partners also experience an increase in these hormones during the labor, during the birth, and during skin to skin. So skin to skin doesn't just benefit the baby, it also benefits both of the partners caring for the baby. So I hope you learned a lot about hormones in this video. If you'd like to learn more about the hormones of labor, I'll link below this video to a resource called The Hormonal Physiology of Childbirth by Dr. Sarah Buckley, published by Childbirth Connection, and I'll link to that below.